Let's go to New York City, where Liam McEneaney is standing by. He is back for the holidays. Welcome, Liam McEneaney.
Hey, David Feldman. Happy Thanksgiving.
Oh, yes. Well, it's Black Friday. It's 3 a.m. We post this show at 3 a.m. on Black Friday, Eastern Standard Time. So,
oh, in that case, what's up, my man?
No, not that kind of Black Friday. Come on, Liam.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
I thought you said Hack Friday. I made the most obvious joke I could think of.
Yeah, and I want to pretend that you and I actually spent Thanksgiving not thinking about show business, if you want to call this show business.
No.
This is desperation business. Let's be honest, this is Thanksgiving Day, folks.
Yeah, no, it's Thanksgiving Day. I'm spending the morning not with my family, oddly enough, but in my parents' guest room. Recording David's podcast.
I swear to God, I am in my mother's house. I don't want to call it a guest room, but it's sort of a guest room. It's my old bedroom that's been turned into a, I don't know what she's turned it into, but I'm at my mother's, and we are spending Thanksgiving alone, the two of us. That's it. That is it. No.
My family loves me, but for some reason I'm here right now.
But what? I don't get that.
I mean, I could be downstairs right now with my family who loves me. Helping set the table, eating delicious food, but for some reason I'm upstairs talking to David Feldman.
And our listeners.
And your listeners, of course.
Who will be...
Listen, I do it all for the fans.
They will be listening to this on the way home, either from a Thanksgiving journey or from a Black Friday sale. Right?
I think it's very generous that you're pretending your fans aren't a group of shut-ins. who maybe have people in their lives. I think it's very sweet.
Well, I think I've become a shut-in. I've become my biggest fan. I'm a sad, pathetic hump. I am. I'm in a bedroom at my mother's house doing a podcast. I'm Rupert Pupkin. From the King of Comedy. I should have cardboard cutouts of my podcast guests.
No, because Rupert Pupkin had his sound effects with him.
He did have his sound effects, and he actually succeeded. He had the balls to actually do something about his career, as opposed to live in the fantasy world of a podcast.
Hey, man, I'm not going to put Rupert Pupkin down because he has one more network credit than I do. I mean, I've never done late night, you know?
You've never done late night?
I've never done late night.
Well, there's still time for late night to lower its standards.
You know what? I've seen some of the shit that goes on late night now.
Yeah.
If I'm not that good, I'm never going to be that good.
Well, yeah. I don't want to, watching that stuff on TV. I was explaining to somebody that it can't be too good.
Right.
If it's too good, then people are offended. Good comedy offends people.
Right. So, it's true.
Tell me about your Thanksgiving. So let me tell you about mine. Because here's what's really pathetic and depressing about my Thanksgiving. I am so happy. I am so happy because my sister went to California.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. And my daughter and I were going to spend the most depressing Thanksgiving imaginable with grandma. The three of us decided, let's have a depressing Thanksgiving.
Right.
And just go right in into it, you know? And because on the West Coast, where my old family used to be, my ex-wife, and they're having this big, you know, 400,000 relative type of Thanksgiving.
Right.
So we were going to do the anti-Thanksgiving.
Right.
And
just a real spite fest.
Yeah.
Just really stick it to your ex-wife by having a terrible time.
Yeah. Yeah. I have to blow my nose. Hang on for 1 second. Hang on. I don't think I have a cold. I think I'm just allergic to success. And it sounds like your life is more successful than mine. So
No. This is definitely the antidote.
Nah, you're doing better than I am. Because you're actually setting a table with your mother and making plans. I'm going to Subway to get her a turkey sandwich with all the fixings.
No.
I'm serious. I am absolutely serious. We are rejecting Thanksgiving. My mother, I can't discuss my mother's politics because she's still afraid of the FBI.
Right.
Seriously, she has a history from the
from the Weathermen Underground.
Well, earlier than that, but let's just say that there's a FBI file on my mother that's thicker than Dick Cheney's arteries, and.
You know, we got to find out if my dad has an FBI file. Thanks
he
for
does.
Reminding me.
Everybody has an FBI file.
No, but my dad was a young socialist, so he might actually have like a real.
Yeah, I'm sure he does.
FBI file.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the fear. The only reason most people of my parents' generation don't use a Freedom of Information Act application is they're afraid there's no file on them. So anyway, so my daughter calls me up last night and says, hey, you know, I was thinking, you know, that really depressing Thanksgiving we're planning. It's depressing. So right. I'm not coming.
Good for her.
Yeah. She said, I know you're doing it ironically, but it is Thanksgiving and most people. And she said, I got a better invitation.
Well, yeah.
And you know what that invitation is?
What's that?
To serve at a homeless shelter.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah. So well, I said, so you would serve homeless people over your own father.
Hey, man, you know how hard it is to get one of those gigs on Thanksgiving?
I know. You're right.
They fill up quickly.
I know. I know. I agree with you.
Yeah, it's kind of like one of those O. Henry stories. When you're leaving the shelter to go visit your mom for Thanksgiving, and then she's going to serve at that shelter.
Yeah.
Where you would ordinarily be having dinner.
Yeah. That's their big day. Thanksgiving. That's where they make all their, it's kind of like Black Friday for homeless people.
Yeah, I used to volunteer at like the Bowery mission or whatever.
Yeah, I remember you used to say, hey, I'm not going to finish this coleslaw, you want some? That was very giving of your. Did you at the Bowery Mission?
Yeah, and a couple of other places in New York when I was younger.
Yeah. Homelessness is not funny, by the way.
Well,
depends. Nah. It's a disgrace. I don't want to go there. And, you know, I guess people who are... I was talking to a friend about this. Maslow's Hierarchy of Needs. I go by Victor Laszlo's Hierarchy of Needs.
Right.
Which is make a deal with the Russians. I can't remember the third man, so forget it. Wasn't Victor Laszlo from the third man?
Right.
Yeah. Okay, great.
You could have gone Laszlo Toth's Hierarchy of Needs.
Don Novello. That, how did you know who Don? How did you know about Laszlo Toth?
Oh, when I was a kid, I saw Laszlo Letters for Sale at Barnes & Noble, and I bought it.
Greatest, greatest, greatest book. Greatest book. Explain the Laszlo Toth letters.
Well, Don Novello, who your listeners probably know as Father Guido Sarducci, from the 1970s era of SNL, which was 40 years ago, would write to various public figures and corporations.
Instead of phony phone calls, he would write phony letters.
Right. And they would all respond to him. And then he put all the letters and responses in. But his letters were always like, you know, super supportive of President Nixon. Like, he would write to President Nixon.
Right.
Telling him that, you know, the country is behind him. Or he'd write to McDonald's and tell them how amazing their food was.
Right, right. He would sucker them in. Boy, that really, you know, I haven't read that since it first came out. And I remember it being absolutely hysterical. And I think it shaped my comedy. That you what you do is you sucker them in first and compliment them.
Right.
And make them think you're an ally. And then you blow their mind with some ridiculous request. I can't remember anything from those letters other than they were absolutely hysterical. It was like the anti-Jerky Boys. I mean, the Jerky Boys just come in swinging.
Right. And they're over the top characters.
Yeah. My son, I played the Jerky Boys for my son 20 years ago. And we were laughing and laughing and laughing. And now, you know, I've forgotten about the Jerky Boys.
It doesn't really hold up.
Yeah, the characters do. The voices do. He and his friends listen to it. They've rediscovered it. And Cumtown. Do you listen to Cumtown?
No, what's that?
The Nick Mullins podcast?
No, I don't listen to it. What is it?
It's an assault on your sensibilities. It's like all over the map politically. Right. And Michael Brooks, who is, you know, my intellectual Sherpa, loves Cumtown, says it's okay to listen to it. They just don't care. They just don't care, and they go after everybody. And it's really, Nick Mullen is just, I would say to my listeners, if you don't care and you just want to laugh, listen to Come Down. But he will offend you.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's not like a prank call podcast.
No, it's just Nick Mullen and his friends being, they'll say things like, one of them said to Chelsea Clinton in a tweet, oh, why did you, jeez, I won't even repeat it. I can't.
Whoa, whoa.
No.
Why did you what?
No, I'm not going to repeat it. You got to listen to Cumtown. Because okay. If you pull it out of context, it's not, it's just offensive.
Right.
But in context, it's even more offensive. So okay. What are your plans? What are you doing? What are you doing this week?
What am I doing this week? Well, I'm going to be in New York. We're going to have dinner, I think, at some point before you go to L.A.
Yeah.
I'm going to see some friends, and I'm going to just get some, I'm going to do a couple gigs.
Oh, yeah. When are you at the Irish Center?
I'm at the Irish Arts Center next Sunday, December 8th. Sundays at 7 show, 7 p.m. And Ophira Eisenberg's going to be there.
From Ask Me Another.
From NPR's Ask Me Another.
Do you know that my daughter was on that?
You were saying
yeah.
She was a contestant?
Yeah.
Did she win?
Yep. I have to find the episode.
Who was the guest?
I don't know. It was like 2 years ago. But okay. Ophira remembered her. When Ophira did my show, she specifically remembered my daughter. And I said, did she mention me? Can you give her a message?
Is your daughter hot?
I think she pays her heating bill. I certainly hope so.
She's seeing anybody?
She's got a new pair of glasses.
Because, you know, I'm single, so...
She's got new glasses. I'm sure she's seeing a lot of people.
You know, I'll be dead at the homeless shelter later anyway. So I'll try to...
Well, she's got her debugging spray, so she'll get rid of those. Is that what you... So who's coming to your Thanksgiving?
Oh, my sister, my brother-in-law, my nephew.
Your nephew. How old is your nephew?
11.
Can he guest on my podcast? I need guests. Does he have any hot takes on boogers?
You know, if you want to do a 45 minutes on ninjas, I think I got your guy.
Is he funny?
He's a funny kid, but he's not like funny like I am.
No. So he's talented, in other words.
He's very talented. You know, he's a good drawer, too.
Does he have sound effects? Because I don't have any sound effects.
I think if you need a fart noise, he's your man.
Okay. All right.
But yeah, no, he's very cute. He's a good kid. I like him a lot. And that's it, really.
All right. So we should do listener mail, right?
My family's dead. So anyway, go ahead.
I don't have my
grandmother and my aunt passed away last year, as you know. So
if I had a sound effects machine, I would be able to get. All right, I'm going to my file, but before we do, the Deutsche Bank executive who signed off on Donald Trump's unorthodox loans killed himself in his Malibu home on November 19th. We're just learning. Thomas Bowers, who headed Deutsche Bank's American Wealth Management Division. He was in charge of Trump's private banker. He committed suicide by hanging.
Wait, let me guess. He hung himself in Jeffrey Epstein's cell.
Very good. I can do my old joke. He hanged himself to heighten my orgasm. Well, when people start committing suicide, it's bad. Not bad that he committed suicide. It's bad for Trump, and it says that people. There's obviously something that Deutsche Bank is hiding. Now, the question is Anthony Kennedy, the former Supreme Court justice, his son also worked for Deutsche Bank and was signing off on these unorthodox loans to Donald Trump.
Right.
So we'll see what's happening there. But you go ahead. What did you have to say?
I was just going to say, did he really hang himself?
Yes. Oh, well, do you think Jeffrey Epstein really hanged himself?
I don't even know if I believe Jeffrey Epstein's really dead.
Okay.
I honestly don't believe he's dead.
Okay.
But yeah, no, that sounds, well, I don't know. Is it a loss? I don't know.
Well, the sheets that he hanged himself with, we'll never have those back again.
You know, David, I'm just a simple blue-collar guy.
You're working-class fancy.
Working-class Joe Sixpack kind of guy. I don't know too much about this politics.
Tim Allen. Is decrying the thought police. I wonder if he's going to turn some of his friends over to the thought police so he can get a lighter sentence.
Well, you know, thought police have never.
What is that scratching sound? What is that scratching sound?
I don't know.
That. What was that?
Oh, I think I might have been talking to the wrong end of the. Could you still hear it?
Yeah, but you were talking to the wrong end, is what she said.
Hey-o.
I think she said that once.
Oh, I was about to get off a really good one about how the thought police will never arrest his audience or something like that. I don't know.
Oh, because they're thinking.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I like that. Yeah. Well, maybe if you learned how to talk into a microphone, your jokes would stick.
I don't know which end of my iPad is which.
Oh, you're doing this on an iPad?
Yeah. This is my first time recording something through my iPad.
It's not bad.
No, it sounds pretty good, right?
Well, now it sounds even better.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, well, now I just learned which end of the iPad the mic is in.
Okay, now do you know your ass from your elbow?
Sure. Hold. Oh, man, I just took a shit out of my elbow. Well, that explains my trouble playing tennis. Hey, folks.
You have tennis asshole.
I do.
Yeah. yeah. So you're going to spend time with your. We have a lot of listener questions to get to. You do realize that.
All right. So
what was that beeping sound? What was that beeping sound?
That's my sister texting me. She's bringing me coffee.
You want to hear something? I'm not. I swear to you, I'm not allowed to drink coffee in this room.
Really?
I swear to God.
How old are you?
Old enough to not spill coffee on. Yeah.
Is she afraid you're going to ruin the rubber sheets or the manacles in the wall or the various chains and apparatus? I mean, those are very expensive.
Oh, that's right, because you know about my mother's side hustle.
I have friends in the BDSM community. It's a very expensive hobby.
The BDSM?
Yeah.
So you want to tell the audience what my mother does to supplement her Medicare?
Yeah, she, you know, she takes various lonely businessmen.
Yes.
Not unlike her son.
Yes.
And chains them to the wall.
Yes.
She humiliates them.
Yes.
Privately. Yes. Telling them that they're worthless.
Ask to see their report card. I want to see your SAT scores. Let me see the envelopes from the colleges. These are all thin envelopes. Nothing thick.
And she humiliates them publicly by telling them that they're by telling all their friends that they're fans of the David Feldman show.
Yes, she humiliates me by telling her friends to listen to my show. She's playing the long game when it comes to humiliation. Yeah.
But yeah, let's get to some listener questions.
Well, I want to hear your sister bring coffee.
Oh no, she's not here yet.
Oh, she's bringing coffee for Thanksgiving.
Well, my mom doesn't have coffee in the house. My parents don't have coffee in the house, so.
Why?
Because my dad drinks decaf. Well, they both drink decaf, actually.
How do they get out of bed in the morning? Oh, they hate each other so much, they just, ugh. That'll get you up and out of the bed. Look at you. Ugh. Can't believe I'm still married to this witch. How do you, yeah, I mean, that's a good, that would help me kick caffeine. Being in a loveless marriage.
Well, they're not in a loveless marriage. You know,
they love each other.
People can love each other without liking each other, David.
Well, so Thanksgiving, describe it. There's your mother is setting the table.
Well, I guess I would theoretically be helping her set the table, except I'm podcasting.
Right. And are you a prince? Because I'm a prince.
What does that mean?
means I hang out with convicted child molesters in their Manhattan apartment. Oh, that's Prince Andrew. No, I'm a prince. I just have to show up.
Oh, no, no, no. I do have to help.
Well, I have to show up. And then it's kind of like being Queen Elizabeth's son. I show up. They comment on my appearance. I have to wear a costume.
Right.
And at first there's adoration.
Right.
But then my mother turns into the paparazzi, or the mamarazzi, actually, uh-huh. or just a Nazi, and violates my privacy. And the adoration turns into they're haunting me. And it's really like being a member of the British royal family. I relate. I really do. I really relate to Prince Charles because
nobody likes you.
Well, yeah, I become this simultaneously. I'm an object of adoration and ridicule in my family.
Right. I would say I'm more like Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher.
How's that?
I'm very divisive.
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't know. I just, I would say I just show up. I do what I'm told and I eat. I'm more of a scullery boy, maybe.
Ah, scullery boy.
More of a chimney sweep, maybe.
Ah.
You know?
Yeah, you're more like a chimney. Because to make everybody laugh, you show up to dinner in blackface.
Hello, Governor. It's good luck to shake my hand, it is. Hello. Blow me a kiss, and I'm lucky too.
I have been told that Mary Poppins is one of the greatest movies ever because it breaks all the rules. I haven't seen it in years. It breaks the rules in that nobody is bad. It's not formulaic because there isn't a single arch enemy. There's no anti-hero in Mary Poppins.
You know, it's funny. I actually watched it on the flight over.
What else were you on? What else were you on? Ba-dum-bum.
No, my flight here took about 10 hours. Because first, an old lady got sick and threw up all over her row.
Oh, hang on. You're bearing the lead here. Hang on for second. You're bearing the lead. You flew from L.A. to New York. When?
Monday.
Out of what airport?
Burbank.
I like that airport.
Sperm Bank Airport.
Did you just make that up?
Yeah.
Good. And so an old lady from Burbank threw up where?
All over her row in the airplane.
All over her row.
Yeah.
Okay. Now we're getting somewhere. Now we're getting
boarding.
This is what I'm talking about, Liam.
Right.
This is what we should have started the episode with, because I have listeners coming home from Thanksgiving.
Right.
This is Black Friday.
Right.
They just experienced the busiest travel day of the year. There might be listeners on a flight right now.
Right.
And you're holding this back. So when people were boarding.
In fact, I was the last one allowed on the airplane before they stopped boarding. So a handful of us were sitting there in our seats watching them clean up that row for 45 minutes. And I'm sure everybody else was still at the terminal, completely furious.
She threw up all over the road. Did she throw up on anybody, I hope?
I think so.
Good.
Because the two people who shared a row were also seated. And they got off the plane.
Yeah.
By the way, they didn't make this lady leave the plane. They let her fly all the way to New York.
Wow. And did the plane smell of puke?
No, they cleaned it up pretty well.
They can't open a window. They don't open. Maybe they opened the doors, right?
Yeah, the door was open, and they were using all kinds of disinfectants. But, you know, I was just grateful that our flight crew were all trained medical professionals who could determine she wasn't too sick to fly.
Yeah, yeah. And what's the vomit fee? What do they? I bet they have to charge her.
I don't think so.
They charge the other passengers for the vomit.
Well, they charged me $20, but only to watch.
Wow. Was she an old woman, a young woman, a drunk woman?
She was old. She was elderly.
She was elderly.
Yeah.
Maybe she said, this is my emotional support gut biome. I can't fly unless I throw up all over these seats. That's my emotional support gut biome.
So then.
So you get on the plane and you don't smell the vomit, but you smell the cover up, right?
Plus, I was still jerking off. So.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll get to that in a second. Would you rather smell the Febreze or the
I would rather have been airborne.
You would have been what?
I would rather have been airborne because then by the time they finished, the winds had gotten really strong and we couldn't take off.
The winds got really strong.
Yeah, the winds were too strong for us to take off. So
it was a headwind or a tailwind?
Yeah, you know, Edwin. Hello, I'm your pilot of your plane.
Oh, Edwin. Edwin. Was he in Mary Poppins?
He was in Mary Poppins.
So
well,
instead,
hello there, David. I'm the pilot of your flight.
So instead of tail or headwinds, you had Edwins.
Right. So we
and look how we circle back to Mary Poppins. So you watch Mary Poppins.
Oh, no, I'm not done with the story of this flight.
Yeah, but it includes Mary Poppins, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, so you took an umbrella to New York instead of a Boeing Max.
I sat on a cloud and waited till I was summoned.
Ah. Okay.
Anyway, long story short.
No, you can go long. It's Thanksgiving and I have no other guests. Pathetic
yeah,
enough
but
to do.
I have to. I have shit to do.
Well, you are doing shit. You're right. You have shit to do. And and that includes the David Feldman, because this is shit. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's all over my elbow.
All right. So you get on the plane.
So then after probably an hour, they tell us that the winds are too strong to take off. So what we're going to do is we're going to dump a bunch of fuel. fly to Phoenix, refuel, and then fly to New York. So then we did that.
So you were in Phoenix?
For an hour, but we weren't allowed off the plane. So really, I saw the best of Phoenix.
did you have a middle seat? Did you have an aisle seat?
I had the aisle seat.
Yeah.
I was next to a mother and her like a 12-year-old son, and they were bickering like an old married couple.
Right.
And she was really mad at him because he was eating too much.
But hang on for 1 second. Are you breathing into the iPad now?
Probably.
Can you stop breathing? Please stop breathing. Please. They were bickering. Was he like Ed's wife from Calabasas?
He wasn't really that fat.
Was it Dave from Calabasas?
Dave from Carlsbad.
Dave from Carlsbad, who has the girlfriend.
Enormous girlfriend, yeah.
And he doesn't have the cojones to tell her she needs to lose weight.
Yeah, so instead he's going to charge people $10 to ride her.
and the letters come in. People complain about those jokes.
Did they really?
Yeah. And they're right.
Who complained?
I get complaints. I do.
Do you really?
Oh, of course. Somebody.
Maybe we should, maybe we should get some of those letters.
Some of those letters aren't funny. They're just true. They accuse me of being a hypocrite. That somebody's totally on to me. Where the first, I would say, 3 hours of the show are politically correct, leftist, and that as you listen, the show turns into a a forum from Breitbart. Like, it just
what?
That as this show progresses, it goes from the far left to the far right. Not really, but if
I tell, when people ask what I'm doing with this podcast, I say your listeners think I'm like to the right of Stalin.
I know.
Or to the right of like Thatcher, actually.
Yeah. But if you listen to the show, right. I keep it the structure, and we've just evolved this way, that the comedy is towards the end and the serious stuff is towards the front. And my serious stuff and my political stuff and my intellectual pursuits are very left wing. The comedy is, I like.
It's come town.
Well, yeah. And, Michael Brooks, Michael Brooks and I were talking about this, that that comedy is different from politics. And you got to be careful. If something's funny, it's funny.
Right.
And funny, if something's funny and you think it's funny, you're also filtering the politics. Like, I don't agree with Chappelle's transgender people material. I don't think it's funny.
Right.
I don't think it's funny. However, when he says he's a Chinese guy trapped in a black man's body,
that's funny.
That was funny. Did you see that?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So that is really funny, and I laugh out loud, and I will defend that to the day I die, because that's just plain funny. The stuff, other stuff around it is, as they say, problematic. So, and I also think that comedy isn't as important as people think it is. And the problem isn't the jokes so much as the oligarchs and the bosses and the politicians. Anyway, go ahead. I just was trying to give myself an excuse to hang myself.
I just realized
that I'm a bore.
No. Your Thanksgiving is somehow more depressing than Charlie Brown's Thanksgiving.
No.
Remember when he had that like one string of popcorn? And for some reason, all the kids' parents left them and they had to make their own Thanksgiving dinner.
I was never a big Charlie Brown. I mean, I read it as a kid.
Uh-huh.
There was something aesthetically satisfying about it. It had a look and an emotion, but I never found it particularly funny.
Oh,
yeah.
There was.
I loved it. But I never laughed out loud.
There's a great strip where Charlie Brown's talking to Linus about how depressing it is that Bob Dylan was only 25 years old. At the time this strip was published.
Okay. Let me find the... Yes, I am a Jew. Okay, let me find the letters that... We have a lot of letters that came in.
How's Laura House?
She's on today's show.
I did a show with her a week ago. She was great.
She's the best. So I guess it was packed. It was just like everybody knew you guys from the David Feldman show, right?
Surprisingly.
Yeah. No?
No, there was a good audience, but they were all like the regular audience of this one show we were doing.
Nobody remembered you from my show? Can't you lie to me?
There was one guy, actually.
Ah, yeah.
But he was outside the theater.
Yeah.
He was sitting on the curb drinking a pint of Wild Irish Rose.
Oh, that was Alex Brazil. Brazil. Too important now.
I tossed him a quarter.
I can't find listener questions. Vamp for a second. I apologize for the pace of the show all of a sudden. Now I'm panicking.
No.
Yeah.
I hope we don't have to end the segment now.
No, I wouldn't do that. We would just run dead air, which would probably be
better. Isn't that what we've been doing? Didn't I just describe a flight?
Well, that was funny and interesting. A woman threw up. Did they introduce her to everybody?
Yeah, they made her do three encores. They made her do three encores.
Okay.
That's funny.
All right. I am having trouble finding, let's see.
Oh, my God. If you don't have any listeners, you can just admit it, David.
No, because I'm at my mother.
I still respect you.
I'm at my mother's and... Hang on. Keep talk about
what was
something.
That noise?
That's my frustration.
Was that Johnny Carson doing the Great Karnak?
No. No, when I get frustrated, I...
A schmuck, a duck, and a...
A cluck. And a cuck.
A cluck.
A cuck. A schmuck, a duck, and a cuck.
Name three things you'll find on the David Feldman show.
Yes. Is it documents? No. The silence.
I'm smelling delicious cooking turkey. Right. Yeah, so I think tomorrow I'm getting a haircut.
Yeah.
Don't worry, David. I'm going to provide some quality content while you look for your listener questions.
Go ahead. Right. You're getting a haircut.
Maybe I'll get my beard trimmed.
You can get your beard trim.
I'm going to get my beard trimmed.
You ever get any trim from your beard?
No, it depends on what she... I'm bringing her to Weight Watchers.
Do you go to Weight Watchers?
No.
Do you go to AA?
I do go to AA.
How was your AA meeting?
It was good. Of course, I'm not allowed to talk about who I saw there.
Right. Well, you're supposed to see yourself.
You're supposed to see yourself. You know, it's also in the middle of Queens, so it's not like anyone, you know, your listeners would know, except Mel Gibson. But everyone else, your listeners wouldn't even know.
Right.
So it was Mel Gibson and a bunch of people whose anonymity I need to preserve.
Yeah.
And Ringo Starr. But other than that,
we don't like Ringo. We don't like Ringo.
You don't like Ringo? Why
not? He's for Brexit.
Yeah, but he's Ringo.
Yeah, but he's also... He should keep his mouth shut. You know?
Well... No, I mean, you know, it's like if you want celebrities to speak their minds when they support you, you got to also be willing to hear them say things you don't agree with.
Well, he should be careful about Brexit. He shouldn't be for it because certainly there was Ringo exit or certainly.
Yeah,
Paul.
No, he lives in Los Angeles now.
Yeah, but Paul wanted
to Brexited 20 years ago.
He Brexited 20 years ago. Right. You're right. And Paul wanted, you know, try to kick him out. Wasn't Paul playing the drums at one time on the White Album?
Well, that was because Ringo was too drunk.
Is that true?
Ringo kind of got his shit together. He played on Abbey Road and Get Back.
I love his music. I do. I think he's elegant. But,
right.
You know, once you go on record saying... All right. You know what, folks? we're going to have to put off. We're going to have to double up next week with the listener questions. Damn it.
So you're saying we're doing a 4-hour segment next week.
Yeah. I'm sorry, people. Can't find it. It's in a file that I dumped inside my, you know, that thing your travel folder, your computer valise.
Your Dropbox?
Your Dropbox, yes. But maybe it's still loading.
You should be able to access it if it's in your Dropbox.
Well, I can't. All right. Sorry.
I mean, all right. Well, happy. What a wonderful way to end an episode.
Yeah. Well, I hope you feel better.
I can't think of a single better way to end the David Feldman Thanksgiving Day Spectacular.
Did they have the parade?
They did have the parade.
And what about the floats?
Well, I mean, you know, like the floats were okay, but there were high winds in New York.
Edwins
in New York. So, like, Dave from Carlsbad's girlfriend had to be held down with ropes.
We had some baby ho Bernie cat questions.
Yeah, she's been emailing me privately.
And how's that going? How's the relationship?
You know, let me open my, you know, I have a listener question.
Oh, good.
A listener question, but I'll read her private email that's not meant for the air.
Not meant for the air. And there is a lot of sexual tension between Bernie.
I don't think there's any sexual tension.
No, I sense that I think you and Bernie Ho Baby Cat are going to make out. I sense it. You're going to see each other and you're going to hate each other and you're just going to go right for each other's lips. I see it. And you're going to make out and it's just going to be raw sexual energy. And then once, like, it's going to be the type of sex that you've read about where you actually hate each
other.
Have
sex?
No, I think the two of you are going to have a type of sex that is not physically aggressive, but emotionally aggressive and satisfying, where you don't like each other. You're tender physically. You don't say anything abusive, but it's you get off on the not liking. You're making hate in a gentle, hateful way where you're not emotionally or physically abusive, but you're celebrating your hate for one another. You're expressing your hatred through your bodies in a gentle way. It's going to be very erotic.
And then she won't let me into my, she won't let me pay for my storage facility. Is that how that story ends?
That's been taken care of, by the way.
Oh, it has?
Yep. Yep.
Oh, congrats. Are you going back to LA?
Yep. Yep. But I actually got somebody on the phone who took my credit card.
Holy shit.
Yeah. Had nothing to do with public storage. It was just some random guy who called. He said, I'll take your credit card. Sure, public storage. No, I just called over there because they were putting a lien on it and threatening my credit. And nobody would help me.
Right.
Like, no friends or family would help me. They said they would, but you can't trust them with your credit card. Can you really trust your own family with your credit card?
Yeah.
I mean, they've already stolen my identity, my children. They took my name. They kind of look like me. I mean, you want to talk about identity theft. They took everything. My kids took everything. They took my identity. I'm just repeating, I think, a possible bit if I work on it. Identity fraud, my kids, something like that. Anyway, the public storage facility is now paid for. Late fees, I had to pay some late fees. But it was a big worry. Now I get to go there next week and see what I have, see what I won from the divorce, because I didn't, I've never been to that storage facility.
David Feldman, come on down.
Yeah. I'm being serious. I don't, I don't know.
You're a contestant on Your Wife is Right.
I have no idea what I got to keep.
Do, 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 do.
Seriously.
Look at that. It's a half broken barbecue grill. And what's that?
Because
some ironically purchased Precious Moments figurines. Oh, you thought it was funny at the time, and now you're stuck with it.
It is kind of interesting because I moved to New York in 2014. I was in an apartment, but I always thought that apartment was temporary. I always assumed I was going to move back in with my ex, that she would take me back. So I really didn't take, I just took work-related stuff.
So you pulled a Felix Unger.
Yeah, yeah. So then I moved to New York and thinking that I was still going to go back to my wife.
Right.
And so she, you know, moved my stuff into the storage facility, which I never, I don't even know where it is. I don't even know what was in. And now, and then the divorce got ugly. So I don't know what I got to keep in the marriage.
You know what would be sad?
What?
Is if you open that storage facility and there's a baby.
Yeah. That's a sweet O. Henry story, isn't it? She gave me the greatest gift of life.
Right.
A dead baby.
A dead baby.
Or let's make it a, let's make it sweeter.
Okay. It's a live baby.
Well, I was thinking more like.
No. But it's baby Jesus.
It's baby Jesus.
And then the
Jesus.
Twist is.
Yeah.
You're a Jew having to raise a Christian child.
And we've got a sitcom.
And you've got a sitcom.
I'm a Jew raising the Messiah.
Uh-huh.
That's, let's go pitch this.
Okay.
A Jewish couple wakes up one morning and realizes the baby they adopted is, it's Jesus. It's baby Jesus.
And then, wait. And then someone's like, oh, are you sure? What do you mean? You've never, are you sure it's not your biological child? And the guy just goes, hey, we're Jewish. And the guy goes, oh, enough said.
What if, hang on, I like this idea. You know Mark Brazil, right?
I know Mark, yeah.
Okay, so pitch this. So it's a couple. They, they get a baby, and they're, all of a sudden, there are these miracles being performed. And they find out that they adopted, they were given the baby Jesus. And we never have to recast the baby Jesus. It can run 10 years, and it's always the baby Jesus. They're just stuck with baby Jesus because, ephemeral religious time moves much slower. So baby Jesus, you know, 10 seasons, he's still a baby performing miracles.
What about if it was the adolescent Jesus?
No, it's baby Jesus. This way it can be about Joseph and Mary.
But instead of a carpenter, Joe is... Actually, it could be a union carpenter.
Yeah. Was Joseph... I thought Jesus was a carpenter.
I thought Joseph was a humble carpenter as well. I thought that was the whole story.
And Mary was really Miriam.
Right.
She could
run a Hadassah.
Can you go call Mark Brazil and pitch this?
I'll call him. I thought you were friends with him too.
Yeah, but yeah, I don't.
All right, I'll email Mark this week.
It's a Jewish couple.
Jewish couple.
We'll call them the Buckmans.
The Buckmans.
And their daughter has gone off to college.
Right.
And no network wants to do a reunion show. So Spectrum. are you going to watch the Mad About You reunion show?
I never watched the original.
Are you saying you weren't mad about it?
I was mad about people talking about how good it was when it wasn't.
You know what it was? It was Seinfeld for anti-Semites.
That's a very good way of putting it.
Yep. Yep.
Also, they were in a relationship. That was the big difference, too.
Now, you dated Helen Hunt's sister, Mike. Not Micah or Mika.
No, Mike.
Mike.
But no, she had just divorced the son of the champ, Leon Sphinx. So she was Mike Unsphinx.
Mike Un.
Mike.
Oh, Unsphinx. Yes. And if, you know, if I, yes, I, yes.
Whoa.
I enjoyed taking that journey with you, Dave.
Yeah, that's a tough one. Mike Hunt,
uh-huh. Sphinx.
That would be, yeah, and in Eastern Europe, that would, what is your name? And if you were an Eastern European and you said, my name is Mike Hunt Sphinx.
Uh-huh.
People in, say, Latvia, Estonia, Lithuania would find that very funny.
Not here in the United States.
Not here in the United States.
Not here in the United States.
But I could hear my grandmother saying that.
All right, man. I gotta go.
All right, just leave the iPad there. Anybody else in the family want to do the podcast?
David, at some point you're gonna have to leave that room. Step into your life.
You know, it's kind of, ironically, this is the room where I used to masturbate.
Oh, hey, are you still seeing that woman you went on a date with?
So hang on. So in a way, I am still masturbating in this room by doing this podcast.
How's that going with that woman?
What woman?
The woman you went on a date with.
Why would I talk?
You seem really happy about it.
Why would I ever tell you about my personal life?
You know, first of all, yeah, I think it's important for your listeners to know that you do have a normal emotional life outside of this show.
Why would you do that to my listeners? Why would you make them imagine that I'm thinking about anyone or anything other than them?
Don't worry, people. He's not going to jump off a bridge anytime soon.
You have to understand something. Adolf Hitler kept Eva Braun secret.
Right.
Because they wanted the German women to think subconsciously that he was available to all of them. John Lennon kept Cynthia secret because they wanted all the Beatles fans to think there was a possibility they could be with John. Sure.
In the episode of Homer's Barbershop Quartet, they kept Marge secret.
Really?
The female fans of the B-Sharps would think he was sexually available.
So there you go.
And then he goes, oh, well, I'm sure if I explain it like that, I'm sure she'll understand. And then you cut to her crying on the bed. And he's like, honey, it's just till the tour of Sweden's over. I just watched that last night.
Really? And yeah, Mary Poppins.
Dude, I got Disney Plus. My life is.
Did you really spring for Disney Plus?
I bought they had a deal where if you bought 3 years in advance for $4 a month, It was like really cheap, so I did that.
But it's for children.
You know what?
You're a grown man.
I'm a grown man, but you know, I want to watch. I want to be able to watch these Disney movies I like.
I have Disney Plus.
You know, I have to say, I watched.
I have Disney Plus. I have Disney Plus. You know, it's just jars of drippings from his wound before he
but
died.
They sing.
They sing. Yeah. Have you heard of Disney Minus? It's called a library, folks.
Hey, yo. Disney Minus is Disney Minus is just the Don Knotts movies.
Those are great movies.
I watched The Apple Dumpling Gang. I was actually surprised. I didn't hate it.
Well, wait a second. Like the Incredible Mr. Limpet, as opposed to the movie about you, The Incredible Mr. Let me just pour my. I have the joke here. Hang on. Let me return to that joke now. There was The Incredible Mr. Limpet.
Well, so the Don Knotts movie.
But hang on for one second.
Just,
then there's
to make
a
this clear. Is The Incredible Mr. Limpet?
Yes. He made a movie called The Incredible Mr. Limpet. Now.
Right. Now I'm in a movie.
Yeah, now Liam McEneaney is in a movie. You.
What's that called?
Let me just.
Keep in mind, we've already established Don Knotts starting a movie called The Incredible Mr. Limpet.
Mr. Limpet. Yes.
Okay. Go ahead.
They're making a movie about Liam McEneaney.
Okay.
Called The Incredible Mr. Limp.
Whoa.
Wrist.
Oh.
Ah, wow. You thought I was going to say.
Yeah, I thought you were going to say wimpy.
Or limp, because because you got off that plane and there wasn't enough leg room, so it was the Incredible Mr. Limp. I can't think of any other version of that.
Okay, so I do got to go.
Hang on, the Incredible Mr. Limp Noodle.
Mr. Limp Noodle.
No, it doesn't. It still doesn't track. What could it be? What could it be?
Well, listen, David, say hi to your girlfriend for
the
me.
The Incredible Mr. Limp. I don't know. I don't know. You're going to hang up on my podcast.
No. I'm not. I would never do that. But
you
I
are hanging
go.
Up. You have to go do what? What do you have to do?
I have to go have time with my family.
So you pick a Jew over your own family. What's the Frank Pantangelo? Who and you're going to sit and you're going to have fun?
Yeah.
And
you know,
reminisce?
If you come over. Oh, you're in New Jersey. Never mind.
All right. Enjoy your mother.
I was going to invite you over, but you're in New Jersey. Listen, have fun with your mom. The rest of us already have.
All right. And plug your
gig. Why should you be any better than the rest of us? Let's get dinner. I'm going to text you to tonight, and we'll
sure.
I want to see you before you leave for LA.
Okay. And when do you go back to LA?
December 12th, 10 a.m. JFK.
Should we? You know what? I'll bring my recording device, and we'll record from my storage facility.
Are you still going to be there?
Yeah.
How long are you in LA for?
I'm there for like 10 days.
Okay. So, both coasts.
Working Class Fancy is the name of Liam McEneaney's comedy CD, which you can purchase on Amazon or wherever fine comedy CDs are sold. And if you want to see Liam McEneaney performing live in New York City, where will you be?
I'll be at the Beauty Bar on 14th Street Friday, December 6th at 8:30 p.m. It's a free show.
Okay.
I'll be at the Irish Arts Center Sunday, December 8th at the Irish Arts Center on 55th and 11th, I think.
Let me do my joke about the Irish Arts Center. How much are drinks? I mean, how much are tickets?
Tickets are $12.
and there is a 200 drink minimum because it's the Irish Arts Center.
That's right.
A 200 drink minimum.
Folks.
All right. And we did this without listener questions or a sound effects machine.
Yeah. So,
well, keep those listener questions coming, folks. We will have a marathon session next week. Can you stand on the line for 1 second?
All right. I'll stand in line.
All right.